Pontiac, but this kind of taillight. They did this a little differently, but they did it on the 64 Olds 98. So they looked at each other's work. But it was these pictures by Arthur Fitzpatrick and Van Kaufman who started me doing automotive illustration.
Amazing, and like the shadows and so forth of the people on the cars when you think about how two different people did it. And then another interesting thing was like Art was, he lived to be 97, and I asked him, he was still alive when I found these, and I wanted to verify what they were. So I just sent him a text with these, and he told me the whole story about them. But I said, what's up with the license plate number 123456, but up here it's 64-113. He said, that's the work order number of the advertising agency. And so down here you'll see 64-113. And then the advertising agency obviously liked blondes because they would put a black-haired lady here and then she would end up blonde, same way here, black-haired blonde. So that's interesting. Then here they showed the front of the car, and the back is what it ended up with. So I am on the trail of one of the finals, which would have been the step in between these two. I'm trying to squeeze him and get that out because I want that to be able to tell this story better. But now, everything else in here is original illustrations from Pontiac designers. So they're all each one of a kind. These are the originals. And Jim Ewan did a lot of these. I got to be friends with him. And Jim was kind of unusual among designers because he was not afraid to show like this under the hood scene. And he was technologically with it enough to be able to do that and make it look realistic. And then he also drew this whole landscape scene with the home and the shady lane and the whole thing. So some of the stuff he did was beautiful. His name was Ewan, E-W-E-N, but he signed his name with three bars for the E. It was for the E. So anyway, he had a daughter in Chicago, and he would stop and visit me in Oklahoma on his way and give me a drawing. And then when I moved here, and opened a museum still on the way to Chicago, he would stop and give me another drawing. So I got to be where I'd call Jim and say, hey, when are you going to come visit your daughter? Anyway, when I did this room, I called him and told him what I was doing. And he kept the drawings under his bed. And he said, I don't need these here. And he sent them all to me. So now I got 12 or 15 more I don't have room for. Now, they would have gotten fired if they were caught taking these home. So, but they were so passionate about what they were doing, they wanted to save them. Does anybody know Bill Porter? He was head of the studio in the late 60s, early 70s. He's about this tall, probably weighs about 85, 90 pounds. And I said, Bill, how did you get him home? And he leans over, quietly tells me, so GM can't hear, and tells me that on days that it rains, I put him on the inside of my ring. How he got home. Now Jim got all his a different way. He went from, he was transferred from Pontiac, Michigan to South Africa. And he there designed mass transit for GM, buses and trains. And he retired from there to Arizona. And they called him from Pontiac and said, what do you want us to do with your stuff? Which just was like stuff he had boxed up and had in a corner somewhere. He said, well, just ship it to my house. So unbeknownst to them, they shipped him all his. He put him under his bed, and then they ended up here. So pretty amazing. Now another thing is I said, Jim, do you have a picture of your studio space at Pontiac? And he said, no, but I'll draw you one. So that drawing you see over there is his space at Pontiac at the studio. And you'll see he has the list or the pile of current Pontiac, you know, car magazines. I said, what's the fishbowl for? He goes, that's where you clean your brushes out. So he used a lot of different, you know, he had airbrush, he had pencil, pen, paintbrush. He used a lot of different things, but I just think that's priceless. Now, as a Pontiac designer, he was not allowed to go to the Chevrolet studio or the Buick studio or the Oldsmobile, but the boss was. So the boss could go along and see what was going on and maybe take this from here and put it over here. If you look at the front of this station wagon right here, that drawing was done in 1965, but that front clip looks an awful lot like a 68 Corvette. You know, even the hood design is very close. Wayne Vieira, who was head of the studio before Bill Porter, drew this Grand Prix concept. It looks an awful lot like a Tornado to me. So you'll definitely see the influence there. So how exactly that would have worked, I don't know, but you know, they didn't want them to be influenced by what the other studios were doing. This drawing is interesting. It's from John Perkins. And because I own that 70 Judge downstairs, he gave me the drawing for the 70 that he did, and he told me that this is where they were working on having Endura on the rear. So you'll see around the taillights and so forth, and under the bumper would be Endura. Well, we know that never happened. It was very costly and so forth. But if you take those two taillight lenses, squeeze them together, move them up, and then take another chrome like on the top, put down below, you got the 70 bumper. So this is done in 67, and they pretty much got the whole thing dialed in already. But what do you see in the picture that's way wrong for 70? Besides the 66-67 tailpipe extension, there's something there that's way wrong. And what it is, it's, I'll go.
Aluminum wheels?
Nope, it's the antenna.
I was going to say that.
Remember, they were in the windshield. Yeah. They ended up
Did they go in the windshield?
Yeah, okay. They were in the windshield, so there never would have been an antenna. Mm-hmm. So, but anyway, neat stuff. Now, across the hallway, you can go in there and look, but when I sorted through all of my library and I pulled out everything that was not Pontiac, it somehow ended up kind of falling in one category. I call it Roadside America. But, you know, we collect stuff and don't even realize sometimes it has a theme until you do something like that. So over there is 4,000 oil company road maps. There's atlases, there's travel guides, there's oil company employee magazines, pictures of gas stations, all that kind of stuff. So that I call that my Roadside America library. So now, after you're done looking, I highly recommend you get on the trolley, go see the buildings and all the cars, and there's food across the street on the square. So thanks for taking the tour.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
You're welcome. I need to go down and start the next.
This small in watercolor. That's hard.
It is in the Route 66. You go about a block and a half down, it'll be on the right. And then you take your car, get your car. You need to take it over behind there.
I got here a little late. These were the originals, and this was the printed.
These are the drafts.
That's the drafts.
That's the final.
Oh,
and the advertising company will modify this a bit and end up with it.
Okay.
And this is rough draft, you call it, but it shows them like rough. And you're like, the advertising agency obviously like was, because we had a dark haired woman here, and she ended up blonde. Same thing here.
See it here, but he got the rain on the windshield. Wait a minute, he even got the rain on the finish of the car.
So cool.
Oh, God.
Awesome.
Unbelievable.
Don't want to miss that.